Hello and welcome to another episode in the Godot Basics tutorial series. In this episode, we are going to take a brief and quick look at the history of Unicode. So before we can get into Unicode, we must first understand where Unicode came from and where long-distance communication started. Now, before the 1830s, there was really no way of communicating long distance between people outside of sending letters. Now, the problem of long distance communication was solved, and we can thank Samuel Morse for this, because in the 1830s, Samuel Morse, along with other amazing inventors, developed the telegraph. And even though the machine was quite complex in its nature, the way it communicated between two different parties was quite simple. It worked by transmitting signals over a wire between stations, a station to send the message and another station to receive the message. Telegraphs only send electric current, so what exactly do you do with it? Well, lucky for us, Samuel Morse, along with helping invent the telegraph machine, also came up with the Morse code. In a sense, the Morse code was a way you could encode messages. Now keep in mind, you would have to press a transmission key in the telegraph to send your message. So the only way to send messages was either by pressing the key briefly, thus sending a dot, or by pressing the key longer, thus sending a dash. Now, on the other end, there's a device that receives the message and transcribes them by marking dots and dashes on paper. As you can see in this chart here, we have Morse code. On the left, we have our English Latin language, and to the right, we have the dots and dashes. Let's segue into Badeau code. So Badeau code is an early character encoding that was invented around the 1870s. Now keep in mind that earlier systems sent characters, such as Morse code, by distinguishing short gaps. In the sense of Morse code, that would be dots and dashes. However, Badeau code sent characters together in a stream. That means each character code was exactly the same length and had the same number of elements. In a sense, the Badeau code recognized the value of sending data by stream. And if we take a look here, everything is 5 bits long. In a sense, you could think of this as the first successful digital code for telegraph. And as a matter of fact, ASCII, which by the way, became one of the most widely accepted code for translating computer text, was inspired by and based on Badeau code. Now, as the years continued, technology started to advance, and one of those technologies that started to advance were computers. However, computers back then, around 1960 or before 1963, had a problem. There was really no way of standardizing how the English-American language was represented in computers. And so in 1963, the American Standard Code for Information Interchange was developed. Now, ASCII includes a definition for 128 characters, 33 which are non-printable, and we went over that briefly in the last episode. Now, ASCII acts as both the encoding scheme and a code point. And on top of that, 128 characters can fit inside 7 bits. Now, you may be wondering, what exactly is a code point? Well, the dictionary definition of a code point is a code position of any of the numerical values that make up a code space. Now, an easier way of thinking about a code point is that a code point represents a numerical value to a glyph. And an example of a glyph just means characters, but it could be anything really, just a visual object. In this case, we have the uppercase A, we have two glyphs in different languages, and of course the infamous emoji. And these are examples of a glyph. And code points tie a numerical value to a glyph. Now, even though ASCII was the standard for the American language, ASCII again stands for the American Standard Code for Information Interchange, And the problem was that ASCII only worried about the English language. And so the problem that arose at that time was that other character sets had come up to accommodate what ASCII left out. Now, you may already see the problem with that. If a code point represents a text to a numerical value and there are other code points out in existence, how are you able to support all the code points, all the languages? Well, that's where Unicode comes in. Now, Unicode is a standard. Unicode aimed to reduce the problems of basically incompatible binary text encoding by being the standard. Now, since ASCII was the standard at the time for the English language, Unicode adopted the first 128 character code point. This allowed Unicode to be backwards compatible. That means if other schemes were to implement Unicode, there would be no issues in terms of binary text compatibility. Now, one thing to keep in mind is that Unicode is a code point, not the encoding scheme. Now, ASCII was both a code point and an encoding scheme, whereas Unicode only cares about being a code point. What this means is that Unicode does not enforce what the encoding scheme supports. It is just a standard for mapping glyphs to a numerical representation. Now, there are a few encoding schemes that support Unicode. For example, we have UTF-8, UTF-16, and GB18030, and they are built to follow the Unicode standard code points. The one that is most commonly used is UTF-8. Now, UTF stands for Unicode Transformation Format, and UTF-8 is a superset of ASCII. UTF-8 can have up to 4 bytes, thus covering the entire Unicode standard code point. Now, in the previous episode, we did a little math to get binaries into decimal, and so you can imagine the decimal value we are capable of having if we are able to use something that is 4 bytes long. Now, UTF-8 requires that each character be represented by at least 1 byte. It's able to represent the first 128 characters of the Unicode set, which is the English language, which again basically copy and pasted the ASCII standard. Let's go ahead and take a quick look at Unicode. Now, I grabbed this image straight from unicode.org. I'm going to leave links in the description down below on Unicode, along with the Telegraph and ASCII as well. Now, if you look down here, you can see a glyph, in this case, the asterisk, mapped to a numerical representation, in this case, 002A. Now, 002A is a little different than what we went over in the last episode. Why is that? Well, Unicode is mapping a visual glyph to a hexadecimal value. Hexadecimal, also referred to as base 16, is another way of representing digits, basically to the power of 16 per digit. Now, for hexadecimal, we use the values 0 through F. Hexadecimal is a good way of representing binary. Let me show you an example. In the first column, we have decimal values. In the second column, we have binaries. And in the third column, we have our hexadecimal. Now, notice how a binary pattern matches to a hexadecimal value. So you can see here when our hexadecimal value is 0, our binaries are all 0. When we have a hexadecimal value of F, notice how all our binaries are on. Basically, they're all ones. So as you can see here, hexadecimal values are a great way of mapping to a specific binary pattern. I really want to drive home the point that hexadecimal values are basically mapped to a binary pattern. So keep that in mind, and we're going to go over a few examples to reinforce this. One last thing before we move on to those examples is that we will be dealing with UTF-8 encoding. Now, UTF-8, as we mentioned before, supports up to 4 bytes. And 4 bytes means that we can support 8 bits, 16 bits, 24 bits, and 32 bits. However, there is a caveat, and that is some bits are reserved and we cannot use them. Now, when dealing with 1 byte, 1 bit is reserved, meaning we have 7 bits that we are able to use. In this case, the 0, or the last binary digit, is reserved. When dealing with 2 bytes, Even though 2 bytes has 16 bits, notice that we only have 11 bits available to be used, and that's because 5 bits are reserved. The first byte, the last 2 binary digits are reserved, and the second byte, the last 3 binary digits are reserved. When dealing with 3 bytes, we only have 16 bits available to us. And notice again how certain binary digits are reserved, and on top of that, they must be assigned the following values that I'm showing you. In this case, the third byte has 4 bits reserved, the second byte has 2 bits reserved, and the first byte has 2 bits reserved. Lastly, when dealing with 4 bytes, we only have 21 bits available to us, and that's because 11 bits are reserved. Let's look at a quick example, and again, we're dealing with UTF-8. Now, in this case, we have the word hi with an exclamation point. And if we go to the Unicode website, you'll notice that the capital H has the hexadecimal of 48 as the code point. The lowercase I has the hexadecimal value 69, and the exclamation point has the hexadecimal 21. So let's go ahead and see how we would be able to convert the hexadecimal values provided to us by unicode.org and convert them into binary. Again, binary under UTF-8. Now, one thing to keep in mind is that all our strings are of the ASCII standard, or basically the first 7 bits. That means that we're going to use the format reserved for 1 byte. That means that the last binary digit has the value of 0 reserved. We cannot touch the last digit. But lucky for us, because we're dealing with the English language, we won't ever need to use that. Now, let's start with the letter H. Now, notice that the letter H is green, corresponding to a hexadecimal value in green. And in this case, let's grab the 4 because that's first. So 4, we look at the hexadecimal value for 4 and we map it to the binary digit, which is 0100, and that's what we get over here. We do the same thing for 8. And as you'll notice here, 8 corresponds to basically 1000 or 1000, if we were just to read it in decimal form, and that's what appears here. And if you were to check the UTF-8 binary for the capital H, you'll find that this is what is given to us. And we can do the same thing for the lowercase I, grab 6, which is this down here. And when we move along, you'll notice that's exactly what we get. Go to the 9, get that as well. And now we're dealing with the exclamation point, which is hexadecimal value 21. And so if we grab the 2, you'll notice that's what appears here. And when we get the 1, that's what appears here. And this seems correct. Notice how at the end of each byte, the 0 is there, and everything else after that we are able to use. Now, that's pretty easy when dealing with the first 128 bits, which is just anything on your keyboard. But what happens if we use something more complex? So let's go ahead and look at an emoji and try to convert that. Now, first we need to find out how many bits we are working with. And to find that out, it's really simple. Keep in mind that each hexadecimal value is exactly 4 bits. And so if we count how many hexadecimal values are shown to us through the Unicode standard, we get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 times 4 is 20. We are under 21 bits. So that means we need to use this specific format when assigning the hexadecimal values into binary. Now, keep in mind, we are working with 20 bits. That means that there's going to be 1 bit left over unused. And that's where this 0x format comes in. The 0x format basically lets you know that if you have anything after, if you have anything left over, just assign it the value 0. And that's what we'll do in this example. Now, keep in mind that everything in blue is reserved. We're not going to touch that. We're only going to touch the x's, and we're going to fill it in based on what our hexadecimal value is. So let's go ahead and take a look at that, starting with the first value, which is 0. Now, 0, if we look at our table, shows that the first 4 bits are 0. And so we replace our x's with those values. We do the same thing for the second hexadecimal value, which is also 0. And notice how, as we fill it in, and when we reach a reserved portion of the binary format, we're going to skip over and fill in the x's after that. Now, we do the same thing with the hexadecimal value 6, and as you can see, it's 0110, and that's what we do, 0110. And basically, we keep doing that for all the other values. That includes the f, which is all 1, and we do that for the hexadecimal value 1 as well, which if we correlate from the table to the binary format underneath, you'll notice it's the same format. And notice how here we have the leftover bit. And because our format is telling us that everything after must be 0, we're just going to put 0. And that's basically it. That's how you can grab hexadecimal values from unicode.org and translate them into the binary format that your computer will take in when reading the file. And that's basically it. This is the standardized format that all computers are able to read when doing encoding through UTF-8 when using the code points provided to us by Unicode. I want to thank the following amazing people who helped me, who basically guided me into a better understanding of the topic on ASCII in the comment section of the last episode. And these people are, and I hope I'm pronouncing their YouTube names correctly, Eniki, Zibinek Fiala, and Great Collapsing Hrong. And basically, in the last episode, they wrote in the comment section, my mistakes in the last episode, and this episode is dedicated to not only correcting my mistakes, but better explaining Unicode. I went over a little bit of history, so please feel free to leave any corrections down below, not only on telegraphs, but on other items I discussed in this episode as well. I love learning, and I love knowing when I've made a mistake. So please don't feel like you are attacking me if you want to correct me, whether you have experience or you're starting new. Check out the links down below on more information. Anyway, thank you so much for joining me. Thank you for clicking the like button and thank you for clicking the subscribe button. If you have any questions or comments, please feel free to leave them in the comment section down below. And I look forward to seeing you in the next episode. Have an amazing day.